shall start to proceed to his defense entitled Interaction Dynamics and Autonomy in Cognitive Systems by Miguel Aguilera. The candidate will proceed with the defense. We'll sit here, listen carefully to you, and then we'll have the interrogation. Okay?
Is focused on the idea of autonomous agency. We have chosen this topic because we find that it can be interesting in the midst of attention that we identify that is repeated through the history of science and the study of lifeline and cognition between holistic and reductionistic perspectives. And when we want to understand, for example, a living entity, we can, on the one hand, analyze the organisms or the self or the intention or other macroscopic properties. Or if we want to understand how the components of the system produce this behavior, we can isolate parts of the system like molecules, cells, or neurons, or tissues. But we have the risk of, by isolating these components, losing sight of the initial macroscopic systems that we wanted to analyze. And this can happen in individual living entities, but it also can happen in collective entities. Like we can analyze collectives or peoples or cultures, but if we want to take a look, a closer look at the components like individuals or groups or institutions that compose this initial macroscopic system, we have the chemical risk of losing track of this macroscopic level when we isolate the initial microscopic level. The other microscopic level. And we find that a notion of autonomy as a scientific account of autonomy is useful in order to assess the identity of these components that are coupled to a system but without being subsumed by it, without losing their specific identity in the interaction with this macroscopic system. And we find that this idea of autonomy is useful for depicting what Varela has called the settler self, that is a virtual identity that has no particular location and is not reducible to the components of the system, yet it is emerging from a material substrate in continuous interaction among the parts that compose the system and especially with the surrounding environment. And we find different concepts and different notions through the history of science that try to capture these two types of properties, the ones that try to understand the persistence of an identity of a system, and the ones that try to capture the coordination or the interaction of the parts of the component of the components of the system and these components interacting with the environment. So our objective is that an idea of autonomy can be useful to put together these two types of properties into one form of organization. And if we look back into operational definitions of autonomy that can help us to address this issue, we find that there is much work developed in the domain of biological or cellular autonomy, like notions of autopoiesis from Maturana and Varela, and more modern notions of basic autonomy in a cellular or metabolic realm, like this from Ruiz-Miranda Moreno, in which they define a basic biological autonomy as an organization in which there is a functional and organizational integration of inner constitutive processes with, for example, a metabolism which is able to construct a membrane that physically isolates the system from its environment, and on second term, of regulation of this boundary or regulation of this permeable membrane by controlling the flows of matter and energy that go through the boundary, and by doing so maintaining the organization of the system. And in that sense, we can enclose the autonomy of the system to the inner mechanisms of the system and the regulation of its boundary. And And this is very helpful for defining autonomy, but it's not always sufficient for what we intuitively define or consider as an autonomous agent in a higher level. And we find that on top of this basic biological autonomy, we can find that autonomy can be extended to different levels and different domains at scales that are much larger than a biological cell. So in that sense, we find that it's useful to define different levels of interactive autonomous agency to capture how autonomy can be extended into other domains that go beyond the basic autonomous organization. And we took this definition from Barendran et al. Of autonomous agency, which states that an autonomous agent is a system that is defined by itself as an active source of interaction according to some self-generated norms. And they describe how a system can do that not only by modulating the physical boundary that boundary of interaction between the system and the external domain, but by modulating the coupling of this system with its environment. So now we are not only modulating a physical boundary, but we are modulating the interaction itself, which becomes constitutive of this form of autonomy that expands the basic biological autonomy. And now, so autonomy may be expanded to an interactive domain on top of the organizational domains of the system at first. And we can think, for example, of a vegetative state as an example of a system in which we can have a perfectly working biological autonomy. We have cells that are self-constituting themselves, but the system is not able to be an active source of interaction in a more sensory motor domain. It cannot be coupled to the world in that sense. And therefore, this autonomy cannot be extended to this new level. But if instead we think of another example of autonomous behavior of an agent, for example, dancing a hula hoop, we can have a system that is defined as a unit, as a dynamical unit, which is coordinating its movement with an environment, which is the hula hoop. It's an active source of interaction because even if there are other forces acting on the system, like gravity or friction or other perturbations like wind, the agent is able to coordinate its behavior in a sense that it's going to maintain a dynamical equilibrium, which is going to be according to some self-generated norms, which consist in keep the hula hoop twirling around your waist. We can think of different situations in which this extended level of autonomy can be broken, can disappear. For example, the hula hoop breaks, or we cannot have access to a hula hoop, and our basic autonomous agency is still working, but this interactive domain has disappeared, and now this autonomy, which is constitutively interactive, is not there anymore. And we can think that this can happen not only when we interact with a non-autonomous environment, but also when we interact with other autonomous agents. Like, for example, a couple dancing, we can identify a system that is a dynamical unit, which is first different from other couples dancing, and it's an active source of interaction according to some self-generated norms, which are generated not in the individual domains of the agents, but in the interaction between the two of them. And also, we can think more examples of collective autonomy, for example, in a dancing multitude, which is again able to define itself as a dynamical unit, which is an active source of interaction with some self-generated norms, which are generated in a collective domain. So we are going to, for this dissertation, we are going to distinguish between two different domains, a neurocognitive domain and a social domain. And for each one, we are going to ask two different questions. The first one is that, is there an interactive domain on top of the biological constitution of the agent which can allow the emergence of an interactive autonomous agency? And the second question is how this autonomous agency can be constructed open this interactive domain. So with this division, we are going to have four different parts, dividing between the neurocognitive and the social domain, and the interactive domain and the autonomous constitution of the agent. And we're going to use the different tools from dynamical systems and information theory and one-over scaling in order to analyze how this interactive domain and this constitution of autonomous agency takes place. So we shall start with neurocognitive autonomy and conclude with the importance and the role of interactive domain in neurocognitive agency. And we are going to do it with a very simple system interacting with an environment, which is going to be a very clever robot. So our question is, how is a domain of interaction constitutive of a neurodynamic system, and how can we quantify what is missing in the case when this sensorimotor domain no longer exists? So for exploring this, we are going to analyze a simple running climbing agent, which is going to be controlled by two oscillatory units with an HKB model, which is a very well-known model, or a very simple model of coordination of two oscillatory units, which has been applied in different instances for analyzing neural coordination. And we're going to connect this neurodynamic model with a sensor perceiving a gradient and two motors driving the movement of the agent. And we're going to adjust the parameters to find a gradient climbing behavior, and we are going to let one free parameter, sensitivity parameter, which modulates different forms of behavior of the agent. We are going to have this cycloidal agent, which has this screw-like movement. We are going to have an agent that will be to the center of the gradient. And we are going to have this spiral movement agent, which approaches more slowly to the center of the gradient. And we can analyze the different behaviors, and we can precisely map the points of transition between one behavior and the next. So we have a precise characterization of the behavior of the agent, and we are going to use this agent to understand what's the role of this interactive domain we were talking about. So in order to assess what's the importance of not only the internal controllers of the agent, but this sensorimotor domain of interaction, we are going to compare two different types of systems. We are going to have the situated HCB system, which is the regular agent interacting with the world, and we are going to have a decoupled HKB, which is the same neural controller of the agent before. But in order to compare the two of them, we are going to feed the decoupled HKB system with the input recorded from the situated HKB. So both of the systems are receiving the exact same input, and we are going to analyze what's the difference between two systems with the same input. But one is connected, one is coordinated with the environment, is able to influence the environment, and the other one is not able to influence the environment, although the signal it receives is structured the same way. So in order to understand the difference between the two types of systems, we are going to use a dynamical systems analysis in order to solve the system. The system is not very complex, it consists only in three dimensions, three differential equations, and we can easily solve the fixed points of the system and find that the system has one attractor and one repeller for both the situated agent and the passive decoupled agent. And we find that these fixed points can show us which are the points of behavioral transitions, and we have three points of transition which correspond to the initial behavioral transition of the agent. So the three eigenvalues that we extract from the situated system allow us to understand what transitions take place and what are the nature of these transitions. We find the regular attractors, or we find the spiral attractors for each kind of behavior. We can explain the behavior of the agent with these attractor and repellers. But if we analyze the passive decoupled agent, we find that the passive decoupled agent cannot account for the transition between the different types of behavior. So in this case, we cannot understand how the system is working if we have just a passive decoupled agent. Secondly, we can not only analyze the behavior of the fixed points of the agents, the attractor and the repellers, but we can analyze the behavior at the transient, of how the system behaves before or after it's in a fixed point. And we find that for the situated agents, the transients are not trivial, they have different time scales of deployment, but the passive decoupled agent has just one simple unidimensional dynamics for the tracing line and an exponential approach. So we find that much of the richness of the dynamics of the system is only captured by the situated agent and not by the passive decoupled agent. After this, we can analyze more complex situations and add fluctuations to the system. We can add a white noise input, a white noise to the input of the situated agent, and find how the situated and the passive decoupled agent behave. We find that the situated agent is able to compensate these perturbations and maintain a small amount of noise in the system. However, the passive decoupled agent is not able to compensate these perturbations. The fluctuations of the system are much larger and they are strongly correlated. So if we wanted to analyze a passively coupled agent which is not really interacting with the world, we will find that we are measuring these very large fluctuations which are not present in the initial systems. And finally, we wanted to have a better characterization of this domain of sensory-motor interaction, and we describe what we call the dynamical signature of the system, which is a statistical function collapsing the phase space of the agent to one of its variables. So we took the three-dimensional phase space and collapsed it to just one of the variables, which is this five, which represents the values of the internal controller of the agent, and we represent the density function of the values of the phi versus its derivative. So we can see how the environment, how the interaction of the environment shapes the behavior of this variable. We find that, for example, for this behavior, we have this structure, and we observe that this structure of the dynamical signature of the agent, it is lost when we have a passively coupled agent. And we can see how different behaviors have different signatures, but they are already lost when we analyze the passively coupled agent. So here we can see what's the importance of the coupling of the coordination with the environment for shaping the internal dynamics of the controller. Even if, again, both of the systems are receiving the same exact signal as an input. So to conclude this part, we can think that some cognitive processes, when they are connected in a sensory-motor interaction, they are constituted by the brain-body environment system as a whole. And in that sense, we cannot reduce the cognitive process to a decoupled or a passively coupled agent operating according to some representations of the world or other detached interaction with the world. And instead, our hypothesis is that neurocognitive autonomy is constituted over the regulation of this domain of interaction. And now we shall pass to the second part of the analysis of neurocognitive agency, which address the autonomous constitution of an agent. For doing so, we are going to analyze a slightly more complex situation of an agent interacting with an environment, but with noise going to have some particularities. So the idea here is that for an agent to be autonomous, it needs not only to be coupled to an environment, to be engaged in an environment, but it needs to be able to actively regulate the conditions of its exchange with the environment. So it needs to be able to modulate somehow this coupling in order to assert its autonomy. So it can, the agent before, we can think that it's only present in an interaction, in a sensor motor loop, coupling with a sensor motor linkage, but it's always trapped in the same loop. But an autonomous agent should be able to engage in one loop of interaction with the environment, disengage at some point and perform other new form of interaction with the world. So somehow our idea here is that an autonomous agent should be able to have this kind of double regulatory loop in which the system is engaged with the environment, but it has a form of internal regulation which is able to generate some patterns that regulate the initial coupling with the world. So this loop here is going to be able to switch between different loops of sensory-motor interaction. And such a model of autonomous agents should be able to characterize properties such as intentionality or meaning or purposeful behavior, which are typically just described in a qualitative way or in a theoretical way and are hard to capture in a more formal analysis. So we want to model a scenario where we can an agent has the possibility of modulating its coupling with an environment. So we have a simple robot with three oscillators, but now we are going to have a slightly more complex environment with two different sources of stimulus, which are going to be two different lights of two different colors, and we are going to add some internal elasticity to the neural controller of the agent. And we have been inspired in previous models of homeostatic regulation of internal neurodynamics, which which proposed the existence of homeostatic regions controlling the behavior of the agent. We could think that an agent has different regions of homeostasis in which the behavior of the system is stable, and whenever the state of the system goes outside these regions, the agent will trigger plastic mechanisms that start changing the configuration of the agent until it finds a new area of a new region of homeostasis. And in this way, the agent can engage and disengage from different forms of interaction with the world. And our objective here was to extend these previous models of homeostatic regulation with the idea that these regions of homeostatic behavior should not only be predefined, but the agent should be able to, in some way, generate these homeostatic regions and modulate them and change its position and in coordination with its engagement with the environment. So we can imagine an agent which is engaged by the environment in some way, and it has a homeostatic region which determines the stability of its behavior, and if at some point the behavior becomes unstable, the agent should be able to generate a new region of homeostasis which allows him to enter a new form of engagement with the world and maintain this new form of engagement with the world if it maintains some invariants or some conditions of stability. And we do so by changing the definition of homeostatic regulation in our system, and instead of defining the homeostatic regulation in terms of the individual components of the state of individual components, we add the idea of a relational homeostasis. So what is maintaining in this homeostatic system is not the state of the components, but the relation between one component and other components. So we have adjusted the parameters of the robot using an artificial evolution, and we found a robot which is able to develop stable preference to one light or the other and modulate this preference. So there's trials when the agent is going to go to one light, and then it's going to change its preference and go to other light for some trials. And we find that the agent is able to do so by changing the shape of its internal homeostatic regions of neurodynamic regulation. And for different trials, we find that we have different shapes of this homeostatic region. So we wanted to analyze to which point this agent will be modeling the behavior of an autonomous agent, and how we can measure so, and what kind of measures can give us an idea of that type of behavior. So for doing so, we have analyzed different groups of variables that control the behavior of the agent. First, we have analyzed what we have called the cell assemblies of the agent, which consist in the activities of the internal oscillators of the agent, which now are going to be three oscillators, which present different types of relations at different points. The second group of variables is what we call the synapse assemblies, which consist in the state of the connections of the synapses between the different neurodynamic oscillators. And we can see that the state of the connections is changing, and we have transitions at different velocities coordinated with the activity of the oscillators. And finally, the last variable consists in the engagement with the environments, with the engagement with the two lights that the agent is interacting with. And so we map the distance to the two lights with this variable L, and we find this behavior, which the agent is going to one light, and at some point it changes its behavior and goes to the other. So we have these three variables, and we are going to use different measures to analyze how they are interacting. So first, we are going to analyze the mutual information, which allow us to understand how much information is shared between the two variables, and then we are going to analyze the transfer entropy to understand how much information one variable transfers to another, how much one variable influences another. So first, we can analyze the mutual information, and we find. And again, we are going to compare a situated agent interacting with its world and a passively coupled agent which receives the same signal than the situated agent, but it is not in coupling with the world. And we find that if we analyze the mutual information between the different groups of variables, we find that whenever the synapses are involved, the information is much reduced and sometimes even drastically. So we find that there is a very clear difference between the two types of agents. Because even if they the different variables have the same levels of entropy, the mutual information is reduced when the agent is not coupled to the world. To have a more detailed picture, we can analyze not only the information they share, but the information transfer. How one variable influences another, how one variable transfer information to another. And we can take groups, pairs of variables, and see how interact with each other at different temporal scales. And we find that some variables influence others at medium time scales, and other influence others in larger time scales. So we can take this map here and simplify it a little bit and find something like this, in which we find that we have arrows of fast timescales and arrows of slow timescales, and we find that for the distributed agents we have this kind of circular relationship between the different variables, in which the environment influences the oscillator at the fast timescales, but the synapses influence the behavior of the agent at slow timescales, and the same happens with the circular regulation between the synapses and the cell assemblies, which the state of the synapses influence at fast timescales the oscillators, and at slow timescales the opposite happens. And we see how the autonomous agency closes an asymmetrical loop of agent-environment interaction with this circular relation between the variables. But we find that for the passive decoupled agent, this loop is broken, and it's broken at two points in which the information of the transfer entropy is reduced. So we find that the agent is receiving the same information from the environment, but it is not able to close these loops of modulation. And this is what distinguishes very clearly the situated agent from the passive decoupled agent. And we can even have a more detail on the behavior of the agent, but by not only analyzing the mutual information in a static picture, but to analyze the mutual information at different moments of time. The mutual information about the behavior of an agent at the end of the trial. And we analyze, for example, the information of the oscillators about the final behavior of the agent, and we find how at the middle of each trial, the agent has maximal information about the behavior, but then its internal configuration changes and the information is lost. But instead, if we analyze the information sent by the synapses and the behavior, we find that the synapses are slowly storing information about future behavior. And this is where the information of the preference of the agent are stored in the synapses, because they are going to control which arc is going to be the future behavior of the agent. But if instead of the situated agent, we analyze the passive decoupled agent, we find that the synapses are not storing information anymore. All the information about the future behavior of the agent is lost. And that here we see how the synapses in this case are no longer able to influence what is going to be the behavior of the agents, and this loop of close regulation is broken. And in order to keep the analysis, we have used some measures of informational complexity in order not only to see the behavior between pairs of individual variables, but to understand the behavior of groups of variables. So we have used this measure of TST complexity that tries to analyze the information that is shared between different bipartitions of the system. And this measure is intended to measure the complexity of the system, to measure how a system can be at the same time integrated, the behavior of all the variables integrated, and at the same time each variable can display its own individual, specific, and differentiated dynamics. So a system with a very high value of TST complexity is a system that is very well integrated, and at the same time it's able to present a very diverse and differentiated behavior at its particular components. So analyzing the levels of complexity in the two systems, we find that the situated agent has a much higher value of TST complexity than the passive decoupled agent. And we find that even if the two agents are receiving the exact same input with the same level of entropy, and its internal variables are going to have a similar behavior individually, and they are going to have the same levels of entropy, the value of overall complexity is much higher for the situated agent, meaning that there is some coordination at different scales of groups of variables that is higher than the passive decoupled agent. And this is interesting to analyze what's the nature of this interactive asymmetry, which in contrast with previous analysis or previous work, This interactive asymmetry doesn't just arise as a directional vector, which states that I influence the environment more than the environment influences me, but it has to do with the coordination between different timescales of the system. And we see that this asymmetry is depicted in a circular interaction between system and environment. The environment is able to influence the system at fast timescales. The system is able to react to the details of the complexity of the signals from the environment, and at the same time, the system is able to act over the environment at a slow timescale. So the system is going to be able to act over the environment at a macroscopic timescale. We find that this is a very interesting definition of this type of asymmetry between a system and an environment, and allow us to understand what's the difference on this interaction, which is no longer neutral, but we can differentiate in an interaction which is the agential component, the component that has an agency, and the environment which is being acted upon. Finally, we have analyzed the long-range correlation of the 1/n scaling of the system, which allow us to differentiate between different types of dynamics based on the relationship between the different timescales of the system. So we can capture this relationship by a beta coefficient, which shows us when the different scales of the system are or equilibrated and the system is behaving at different frequencies, which is typical of self-organized criticality and systems which are able to present, to behave at all different possible timescales. Whenever this coefficient goes to zero, we have a white noise in which we find no correlation. And when this coefficient goes to two, we have a Brownian noise, which presents a strong influence of slower timescales, and it's more difficult to present a fast adaptive behavior. We analyze again the long-range correlations of the system between the situated and the passively coupled agent. We find that the situated agent presents a value of beta which is close to one, suggesting that the agent is critically self-organizing at a point of continuous beta stability, whereas the value of the beta coefficient for the passively coupled agent is reduced, meaning that the different scales of coordination are reduced for this agent. So, to conclude this part, we can say that we have provided a mathematical characterization of properties that have been generally addressed as qualitative theoretical properties, like, for example, the system constitution through an operational closure, or the agent-environment interactive asymmetry in the causal relation by defining this circular interaction between system and environment, and the precariousness of the metastability of the system in long-range correlation. And now we can move to the second part of the dissertation, which addresses social autonomy. And first, we shall start with analyzing the importance and the role of the interactive domain in social engagement. And for analyzing this, we are going to analyze first a simple system of two agents interacting in a simple computer game. So here, the idea is that, as we said in the introduction, autonomous agents can interact with a non-autonomous environment, but they can also interact with other autonomous agents. And our question here is that if it is there an interaction domain that happens at a different level than the dynamics of individual agents, where a kind of a social autonomy or social agency can emerge. For analyzing this, we are going to analyze the perceptual person experiment, which is a minimal framework for analyzing social engagement in which we have two players with a computer monitor and a computer mouse, and they can move in a horizontal world, they can move their mouse horizontally, and whenever one agent crosses the mouse of another agent, they are going to feel a sound or a signal that is going to indicate this crossing. So they are going to be able to generate complex patterns of interaction in this one-dimensional world. So, our question here is, again, what's the importance of this interactive domain, or what role it's playing? How we can compare the situation when we have this interactive domain present, when this interactive domain is absent. So we are going to compare the behavior of genuine human versus human interaction with other situations in which a human is playing with a simple program bot. And the first bot is going to be an oscillatory bot with a very predictable behavior. And the second kind of bot is going to be a more complex bot, which we call a shadow bot, which presents a complex movement, which is going to be something as in the passive decoupled agent is going to be recorded from the behavior of the human. So the structure of the behavior is going to be like the behavior of a human player, but it's not going to be any coupling between the human and the bot, at least in the side of the bot. We tried different measures to analyze what was the behavior of different kinds of interactions, and we find that we could easily find the difference in aggregated probability density functions between many trials of the time between crossings, the probability density function of how much time it takes to cross again. And we found that the difference between the different types of behavior was in the scaling of these density plots, density functions. So we thought that if we in an aggregated plot we could find this scale, these different scalings of different agents, it would be interesting to analyze the individual dynamics you're looking for long range correlation and which is the scaling of the dynamics of each individual trial. So we used one over the scale analysis. We found that many of the functions presented a scaling with different coefficients of beta, so we characterized these beta coefficients to understand what was the dynamics going on at different kinds of interaction. So our idea is first to find if there is a one over f correlations at the behavior of the agents, and if there is any difference between the individual dynamics of the agents and the interactive dynamics, to understand if there is a difference between the individual domain of interaction to the social shared domain of interaction between the two agents. So first we analyzed the one over f scaling for individual dynamics for both the player behavior and the opponent behavior, whereas the player velocity and the opponent velocity. And we find that the player velocity was very similar for all cases. It doesn't matter if you are interacting with a computer bot or another human, you are going to have a beta coefficient which is close to 1. And if we analyze the opponent velocity, we find that the human agent and the shadow agent, which is working for the first, they both present a value of beta which is almost close to 1. And the oscillator bot presents a value of beta which is much higher because it's an oscillatory behavior and it doesn't present this 1 over n behavior. But we cannot differentiate between the shadow bot and the human bot interaction. So instead of the individual dynamics, we measure the interactive dynamics when the human player was playing against an oscillator, a shadow bot, or another human. And we found first that when the human is playing another human, the value of beta is closer to 1 than in other cases. And in this case, we can differentiate between the different kinds of behaviors. The interaction with the oscillator drifts toward brown noise, and the interaction with the shadow drifts towards white noise. So each kind of interaction presents different dynamics. And this is the aggregated plot, but we can also see it in the dynamics of the individual trials, where we still have these different scalings, and in the case of the human versus human interaction, we see a clean one over f distribution, which is not very not present in the others. So to conclude this part, we see that we can identify fractal scaling in genuine human versus human engagement. When we have a human engagement, we can find a 1 over f dynamical distribution with a value of beta which is close to 1, and we can only find it in a shared interactive domain, or it only is specific of a genuine social engagement when it is looked in an interactive domain. We cannot characterize genuine social engagement when we analyze the individual domains of the agent. So this result suggests that the process of social engagement may have, at least in some cases, an autonomy of its own, and this autonomy shouldn't be reduced to the autonomy of the individuals. And in this way, the sensory-motor interactive domain that we found, that we analyzed in neurocognitive agents, might be extended into a social interactive domain. Now we shall start with the last part, which addresses the constitution of collective autonomy in a social realm. So we are going to analyze a particular case of a collective system developing an autonomous behavior. So the question here is, first, if we can define a level of identity of collective agent, and second, we want to explore what mechanisms might be giving rise to this collective autonomy. For analyzing this, we choose a specific topic of analysis, which is rising some academic interest during the last years, which is that of network movements since 2011, like the Arab Springs or the Occupy movement or the 15M movement, which are movements that represent a particular dynamics, because they are movements that they are not based in previous formal organizations, but yet they present strong aggregation dynamics that are able to conserve, in some sense, the autonomy and the diversity of their participants. And this has been labeled as a different kind of collective identity, called multitudinous identities, that tries to explain this coordination, this correlation between a level of strong aggregation and an internal level of multiplicity or autonomy of the components. So, what we want to analyze here, or what we want to explore, is how does a multitude that doesn't have a formal organization underlying it can organize to bring, for example, a democratic demand, in this case, articulated through the through online space and occupied physical spaces like a square. These are images from the Tahrir Square in Egypt, from social media, from the occupation of a square, a campaign square. So we choose a specific case of analysis from this kind of movement, which is the 15M movement in Spain, which was a large grassroots movement from 6 to 8 million of participants at some point, which had an intensive use of social media communication tools. And for analyzing it, we have chosen a large data set of almost 1.5 million tweets from almost 200,000 users between May 13 and May 31. And analyzing this data set, we have performed different analyses in order to try to capture what are the mechanisms that are giving rise to this collective autonomy. So first, we analyzed the transfer entropy between different geographical locations of the system in order to analyze what's the operational closure of the system. So we took tweets arising from different cities and analyzed how the activity at each city, the bursts of activity at each city, influence other bursts of activity at different cities. And so we can map the network of relations, and we can see how at some particular moments the system arises as a system which is strongly connected, and it presents an operational closure, meaning that the system is not only the components of the system are not only following one particular node, but all the nodes of the system are influencing each other in a circular way. For understanding not only how this closure arises, but what mechanisms might be maintaining it, we can analyze the dynamics of the system. And we choose to look for the presence of synchronized activity at different timescales. For doing so, we use a wavelet phase locking analysis, which consists in filtering the activity of the system at different timescales with wavelets of different frequency. And for each timescale, look for links of synchronization which are statistically significant at different points. The number of links of synchronization, for example, we see here that the day where the camps of the protests started replicating in different cities, we find that at the moment in which they start, we have find a strong moment of synchronization. And we choose to show here a particular example of how this synchronization works by the case of one day of particular relevance of very strong activity in social media, which is the day in which one of the biggest camps, which was the camp in Barcelona, was evicted by the police and again was regained by a massive peaceful demonstration. And after that, many demonstrations at most of the main cities in Spain took place in solidarity with the violence in the eviction, and a huge movement was triggered this day from this in reaction to this eviction. So we wanted to understand what was the relation between the internal synchronization and the different states of the synchronization and the embodiment of the protest occupying the streets and so on. So we found that we have at least two levels of collective action. The first level was active mostly in the morning, which was related to Plaza Catalunya in Barcelona, which was the physical location of the camp that was evicted. And we find that we have different hashtags that are active mostly in the morning related to the Acampada Barcelona or the events that were happening in the eviction. And the second level of behavior is happens at a countrywide level of many cities that decided to organize rallies of protest against the eviction of Plaza Catalunya. And we were active mainly in the afternoon after the demonstrators were able to regain Plaza Catalunya. And every city demonstrator decided to bring flowers in order to protest to the eviction. So we can take day 27 and we can analyze the rise of how the Facebook coalitions of synchronous activity emerge at different moments. We can find this coalition in the morning and we can find this set of different coalitions in the afternoon. And we can extract the activity at the main frequency of the synchronized coalition, and we decided to extract these two big coalitions of synchronized activity. And our question here is if we can confirm the existence of two moments of global response, and if whether the system is switching from one mode of engagement to other mode of engagement. So in order to analyze that, we use transfer entropy, but now we didn't measure the transfer entropy in the burst of activity, but we took the activity at one particular frequency, and we analyzed the transfer entropy between the different phases of the different components of the signal. You can imagine different cities that are synchronized, and the phase of these oscillatory signals can transfer information to one another. And so for the two coalitions, we measure the relation between different components, and we can draw something like this with the relation between the activity at this city. And we find that the first coalition, which was taking place when the square at Barcelona was being evicted, the main node that transfers the most information to all the others is the node of Barcelona. So all the network is synchronized, focusing in the node of Barcelona, and at some point a new coalition emerges which overlaps the other one during some hours, and then it's active, in which the node of Barcelona is no longer the focus of activity, the source of information, but information is scattered between other nodes that are organizing these solidarity demonstrations. And finally, the last analysis we made in this part is we want to look for the correlation between moments of embodiment, synchronization, operational closure, and internal complexity. So we can look for the moments, the different days, in which operational closure reaches the whole network, or synchronization is higher than the mean values of synchronization during that days. We want to compare it with the embodied activity of the system, and for doing so we took a database called GDEV database, which monitors news events and with different tags, and we extracted all the mentions to protest in Spain during that time. So we have a signal of how strongly embodied the system is in particular protest, and we find the day with most intense protest in Spain during that day. And we find that there is a correlation between different moments of synchronization and closure and disembodied activity, and we find that the operational closure and synchronization is preceding the arrival of moments of synchronization in both cases. So we can think that the autonomy of the social subject appears to be connected with the embodiment of this interactive domain that first was taking place only in synchronization of networks, and then it's embodied in the street or in the squares and so on. Finally, we complete this analysis with again measures of informational complexity and monographic scaling, and we find that these indicators of complexity are again correlated with all the indicators. So somehow we have this group of indicators that assess the operational closure or the synchronization or the embodiment of the system. They show us how the system is constituted at some particular moments of time. And on the other hand, we have these indicators of complexity indicating that when the system is strongly constituted, it is when the system has the highest internal complexity. So it indicates that the type of subject that is emerging here is based on this internal multiplicity and internal complexity. And also we see that these moments of constitution of complexity are not random moments, but they coincide with the first qualitative city protests of the moment of replication of camps and different cities, or the selection of the sector local. They are coincide with moments of particular relevance in the embodiment of the system. So we can conclude that social agency, at least in this case, in this type of movements, cannot be reduced to ideas of political representation or a fixed bureaucratic organization, and instead we have identified mechanisms of constitution of this social agency like operational closure or tracing with this synchronization or this internal multiplicity, which portrays a very different kind of social identity, which we have labeled by this idea of multitudinous identity, to understand that it's a specific case of collective identity based in this internal multiplicity or this transient synchronization mechanisms at different time scales. And now we shall present some lines of discussion over the contributions. And we can say that first, that in the first part of the dissertation, we have contributed to the development of a modeling route for testing, comparing, and validating hypotheses about neurocognitive autonomy. And this modeling route can be helpful for generating proof of concept for some properties of cognitive autonomy, like the how operational closure emerges, or how what's the role of an agent environment interactive domain. And it also can generate new predictions about the nature of autonomy, like multi-scale symmetry breaking we were seeing, in which the agent has this circular relation with the world, or the double metastable regulatory loop, or the coordination of spatial and temporal multi-scale complexity. For the second part, we have explored the extension of our model of cognitive autonomy to the social realm. We have analyzed the constitution of a collective subject in the sensory domain in a social interactive task. We have analyzed the emergence of an autonomous social identity in a large scale technologically mediated social system. And we see that the similarities between social and neurocognitive autonomy, like the transient coalitions of embodied action or coordination of spatial and temporal multi-scale complexity, can provide new conceptual and analytical tools for thinking about social and political autonomy. In a more methodological domain, we have identified how indicators of complexity, like informational complexity or metastable synchronization or critical scaling, can act as proxies for quantitative and qualitative aspects of autonomy. These indicators are not per se sufficient for detecting if a system displays an autonomous organization, yet they can enrich the qualitative intuitions indicating so. Moreover, furthermore, we see that conceptual aspects about how we apply these indicators, for example, for depicting the operational closure of a network or for comparing between situated and passively coupled systems, provide a rich perspective for testing specific properties of an autonomous system. From this work, we see that we have two possible lines of future development. One would be the experimental validation of the results of models of neurocognitive autonomy. We have analyzed two different models, but we could extend this analysis to real cases of neurocognitive autonomy of subjects embodied in some particular task. The second line of development would be a further theoretical and experimental support of the similarities and specificities of social autonomy respect to models of neurocognitive autonomy, and understand better and have more evidence about how they might be similar, the autonomy in social and neurocognitive domain, and especially what particularities of the social domain cannot be captured by autonomy in neurocognitive domain. So to conclude, we find that, as we introduced at the beginning, autonomy can appear as a conceptual tool to break the neutrality of systemic perspectives. It can be a tool for distinguishing between the actions of an agent, which is asserting its identity and modulating its interaction with an environment, with respect to other situations in which maybe a system or an agent is just being dominated by exogenous or some harmful or prejudicial endogenous dynamics. So we have a framework that allows us to distinguish between dynamics of self-determination versus dynamics of subjugation. And the notion of autonomy, autonomous agency that we have presented here, proposes a framework that allows us to quantify, to model, and to analyze the way in which interactions themselves allow living entities to emerge as self-referential, and self-modifying, and self-sustaining dynamical process which enact their own world. And we modestly hope to have contributed to the development of this notion of autonomy and its explanatory potential, which may help us in this endeavor. So, many thanks for your attention. I will end the presentation here.
Thank you, Miguel, for your presentation. And the first thing that comes to mind is how rich and full your dissertation is in terms of topics, of ideas, and methods. And in that sense, I really like to congratulate you in the sense of bringing together all kinds of interesting tools for analysis and applying them to questions that are not easy, you know, questions that are quite complex, that we often have to just be happy to discuss such questions or such notions as autonomy or interactions at a purely verbal or conceptual level, and how important it is to just bring this into operational descriptions that allow us to do experiments and so on. So that I quite enjoy that overall aspect of the whole thesis, as well as the whole wide range of topics that somehow end up falling within the idea of autonomy and the ideas that you investigate. So I would have lots and lots of small questions and clarifications, but I think to try to maybe focus on a comment that addresses more than just one of the models, and just one thing I noticed, especially when you compare the models that have to do with neurocognitive autonomy and agency with the social models, the interactive one and then the collective. One thing you notice is that at some points in the thesis, the ideas of autonomy and the idea of agency seem to slide into one another. At the neurocognitive level, there seems to be a clear idea when you say, well, we have an autonomous agent, and it is autonomous because of this reason, and it is an agent as well because of this reason. And one can conceive of identities that are not agents, something like a cell that is not interacting with the world, or even, and this is driving to my question, when you look at the social interaction case in the perceptual crossing experiment, that you show how the interactive dynamics seem to have a certain autonomy of its own. It's not the same to say that that concludes the question of whether that identity is also an agent. In the case of a social interaction, it seems like a question that is not that interesting, because we may have an ongoing social interaction, and that in a way
whenever I ask the question whether our interaction is also doing something in the world. But if you translate that, this worry into the last part of the thesis, when you say you get collective identities or multitudinous identities, the question, and actually politically interesting question, is are they also social actors? Are they also agents? In a sense, and there is something what you say that might give us some clues that may be the case, because all these correlations with the embodied parts of it. But still, how would you go about trying to go deeper and prove that when they get together and they get into this local religion, they also become social actors? Because social actors, you know, remember the requirements for agency, you've got normativity, asymmetry, and so on. So what are the norms? What are the things that they're achieving? What is the history that they're going of interactions with their environment? So maybe I wanted you to comment on this, on these issues a little bit too. Okay?
Okay. Yeah, that's a really interesting discussion. And yeah, it's true that the two parts of the dissertation addresses the first part, probably addresses this issue much more precisely than the second part. And our idea here is that we have definitions of autonomous constitution, for example, Hassel, but this is a different, it does not necessarily imply that this level of agency is extended to, for example, a sensor motor domain in which the system is coupled to the environment and modulate this coupling. And in the first case, we can have identified how this robot, this robotic agent, is interacting with the world and present some. We can characterize how the asymmetry is happening, and even if we deepen the analysis, we could analyze which norms are arising that guide the behavior and so on. And our idea, with the contribution of this thesis, especially in the first part, was not only to say, okay, we have autonomous agents, we have a different kind of autonomy that basic autonomy of the constitution of an agent, which may take place at different levels, but to think about what tools may allow us to characterize not only autonomy, but this sensory motor or this interactive autonomous agency. And yes, the second part of the thesis in that sense is more exploratory of these levels of autonomy, of interactive social engagement, or this interactive constitution of a social subject. And it would be interesting to get further the analysis of these identities. And for example, in the case of a collective identity, it's not easy to see, understand the relation between this internal organization and embodied activity. In this case, the signal we had was very scarce, the number of demonstrations each day. But we potentially have the tools for understanding if the relation between this collective movement and its embodiment is that of an agent, or even in the case of a cell, we could have the tools to analyze if a cellular autonomy is interacting with the world as an agent or not. Mm-hmm. So yes, probably the dissertation doesn't completely ask the question of whether a collective agent of this kind, this kind of multitudinous social organization, is an agent. We provide some clues of how what's the relation between the internal organization and multiplicity or and embodiment. But yes, of course, it will be interesting to apply this analysis we performed the first part to richer cases of the of collective embodiment, in which we can analyze these relations, analyze if they are asymmetric.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so this is it with Seth Fuller now?
Thank you. So I think my first comment, thank you for the presentation. I thought that was an extremely interesting account of the thesis, which was very broad, very deep. There's a lot of material there, and I think you did an extremely good job of being able to present it in a coherent way that I think people could understand. And in general, I think what impressed me as I was reading the thesis was the combination of, there's a lot of historical treatment of the concepts that are at the root of the problems that you're dealing with, but there's also this ambition to take on very many different methodologies. So, whereas many theses that I've seen would have taken one of those tools, dynamical systems analysis, or networks analysis, or information theoretic measures, the ambition to combine those in parallel.